The following podcast is a Dear Media production.
In a study by Esquire, 54% of women said they'd rather be hit by a car than considered fat. If I'm being honest, I've been those women. So for me, this isn't just a podcast. It's personal. I'm Danielle Robay, TV host and journalist, and years of celebrity interviewing taught me that beauty isn't about what you look like. It's about who you become. Each week, I'm having thought-provoking conversations, digging into the stories of people who put a new spin on pretty. From entrepreneurs and authors to politicians and celebrities, no topic is off limits. So join me every Thursday for a new episode to feel pretty inspired, pretty seen, and best of all, pretty smart.
Hey everyone, Molly here. I don't know if you know this about me. I don't actually even talk about it on today's podcast, but I love surfing. I don't actually surf, but I love surfers. I love watching surfing. Surfing lives in my bones. My dad was a surfer. So anyway, I was so excited when I got the offer to interview Thad Zelkowski today, because he wrote this really great book on surfing and addiction. And I enjoyed our conversation so much more than I even thought I was going to, because, you know, I certainly think that we intended to talk a lot about surfing, but we actually ended up talking so much about what you do when you have decided that unhealthy things aren't working for you, when you decided that binging, restricting, purging, alcohol, shopping, swiping. There's this point when we decide that we're going to, you know, do this brave thing, give up the substance, give up what we think is problematic. And then we forget this other part, which is, oh no, now there's this hole I got to work through. And you know, there's a lot of brain science in it today, which you know I love. And I love because it validates, you know, what we feel. And there's a lot of solution in science these days in addiction and trauma. We talk a lot about that. But also, two quick more things, and then I promise I'll give you the podcast. But, you know, we also talk about the importance of finding things that bring you joy. And I think in this fast-paced world, you know, joy seems like a luxury. When it comes to healing addiction, it's a necessity. And for many of us who are, you know, who identify as addiction or identify as sort of people who go big and go home, you know, a lot of times the solution in our joy needs to be a go big or go home solution. So I loved getting to talk to Thad today. I really did. And so I hope that you love listening to us talk to you, and I hope you get a little more info and insight and maybe even some tools to figure out what you're craving so you can live a happy, big, beautiful life that you deserve. I'm so excited today. Thad Zelkowski, did I do it right?
Thad, like Thaddeus.
So what we're saying is I got the last name right, but right, not the first name right.
Yeah, it's endless.
Thad and I were just talking about saying his last name and how it looks harder than it is. And I thought that was just such a great metaphor for life, which we're going to get to all the metaphors today. But let me get to the bio first and foremost. Thad Zelkowski is an award-winning author and of the memoir On a Wave and Wichita. And drumroll, The Drop, How the Most Addictive Sport Can Help Us Understand Addiction and Recovery, which is releasing this week. This little podcast is coming out to celebrate you and freedom and all sorts of things. So July 6th, that comes out. His essays and reviews have appeared in the New York Times, Slate, Book Forum, Art Forum, Travel and Leisure, and Interview Magazine. He has a PhD in English Literature from Yale University and is the recipient of a Guggenheim Fellowship. He is the Associate Director of the Leon Levy Center for Biography at the Graduate Center at CUNY. Welcome. Hi, I'm so excited to talk to you.
Thank you.
I'm a fan of all things surfing, and I'm a fan of talking about addiction, so it's going to be a great day. Your new book's called The Drop, and it's a memoir about your experience being a surfer and in addiction, and then kind of combining with all. Talk us through a little bit about you and how you got to writing this book.
Surfing has always been a very intense connection for me. I started when I was 10. And it had a way of eclipsing all other kind of commitments. And I felt very, very attached to it as an identity. When I quit surfing in order to focus on college, it was like quitting drugs. I always thought of it that way. It's like an addiction I was kicking.
Like when you say it felt like quitting drugs when you quit surfing, like what were the parallel feelings?
A sense of a sort of loss and aimlessness, and also just a sense that I needed to find something else as a powerful to hold me.
Yeah, I think this is such an underappreciated topic in addiction, which is like the void that comes when you, and it's interesting, like in the grief too, right? At 18, you lost this big part of you, which was surfing. So it's like an identity loss.
Right. But it was volitional, you know, I chose it and I had this growing commitment to books and writing and the life of the mind. And surfing was very much the life of the body. And I felt like I had outgrown that and I needed to. But in order to concentrate on reading and writing and getting a real education, which had been suspended a lot by surfing, you know, it was as if when I went to college, I was finally going to school. I had to let it go because it was so demanding as a kind of god, you know, as a jealous god.
Wow.
Surfing was. Yeah. So I had to renounce that god and sort of sign up with other gods.
So yeah, I think that's like a really beautiful way to say it. So it sort of was like your religion and you needed to trade out religion. So what religions did you choose?
Poetry.
Okay.
Literature, philosophy, but ultimately just poetry and writing and to some degree fiction. The thing that I felt and I still feel is that there, you know, it's not about freedom. It's more about finding a kind of workable form of captivity. And for me, this is why surfing works for me now as opposed to then, is that when I got sober, I did it with the help of surfing, because surfing I knew would kind of restore me to a sense of joy and having a body and wanting to be fit and really having that sense of ecstasy that I had lost completely by the time I was in my mid-30s. But surfing was itself this old addiction that I was taking up and kind of brushing off and trying again. To be held by it as an identity and as a practice was something I felt I could afford to do at that point. But it's still another form of captivity. Surfing is not this, for me, and I don't think for any real surfer, it's this kind of, you know, yoga adjacent, radiantly wholesome thing. It is wholesome. It is radiant.
It sounds like devotion is the word I would use.
Very strong devotion.
As you're talking about, right. It sounds like a devotion. Can we rewind? Because we missed, like, spoiler alert. It sounds like the other god you traded out when you traded in, you know, traded out surfing for poetry and comparative religion was also the gods of, you know, cocaine and alcohol. The gods of drugs, alcohol, sugar, I mean, just fill in that void all day. I hear you. But can you talk us through a little bit about like how that happened for you and where you found the bottom to rise up?
It was partly just the romance of the, you know, the drunken poet, the visionary poet, all of those concepts, all of those identities that we absorb through reading about the history of writing. So, you know, the Beats and the Abstract Expressionists and Bukowski and Kerouac and Pollock and so forth. The idea that you could improve your writing or improve your art through altering yourself is very strong. It's still there in the tradition, right?
Oh yeah. Can we just pause on that for people to listen? Because you're a sober writer. I mean, I've treated so many people in my practice who think if they cure their eating disorder, their binging, or stop drinking, that they're going to lose their creativity. I mean, I can't even tell you how many times I've heard that in my career. And by the way, believe that in my own, you know, my own sobriety.
No, that's scary. Yeah, that's a real fear. And I'm sure that was involved in how long my addiction lasted. That's how I justified my exploration of drugs and alcohol, was altering myself. It was also an authenticity thing, you know, it's a mark of authenticity to become an addict, I think, for a lot of writers and artists. So there was that sense of it. And I also felt that it actually focused me. You know, cocaine and amphetamine, if you're a writer, it's very good at first.
Yeah.
So I felt like, well, I don't want to go out and party on this. I'm not going to waste this precious muse-like power. I'm going to stay in my room, which intensified the isolation,
right?
I mean, isolation in general is a big problem is a big background problem, but all
it's the core value of addiction in many ways, isn't it?
Yeah. So it intensified that right away, but I didn't see that as a problem. It just seemed natural to me. And I to be kind of locked into the cockpit of that experience and to be high on cocaine or amphetamine writing in my room all night was to me the highest form of devotion. You know, I couldn't think of anything I'd rather do or be, but it just doesn't, it's unsustainable. It just doesn't work. You know, drugs don't, they straight up don't physiologically work.
Yeah, the house always wins for sure.
The house always wins. And that was something I could not have been told. No one could have told me that. I don't think I would have believed it.
You know what I actually think is really interesting about your flavor of addiction is that I think so often in my story, certainly like my life became the size of a postage stamp. And I was like, all right, fine. Like maybe it is the food, like maybe it is the alcohol, maybe, you know, but as you're explaining your story, like the isolation was actually feeding like, oh, this is great. Now I can really get into like the writing. And it's like an interesting, never really heard it before. So that's,
well, it's also just a kind of autonomy. It's a kind of craving for autonomy and pure independence. I don't need anyone. I don't need anything. Well, let's put aside the fact that it's cocaine, right?
I need nothing except for the cocaine.
Right.
Which requires me getting a drug dealer. Like, it's not like the easiest thing to score cocaine. Let's be clear.
Putting
on that.
That aside, bracketing that one little problem. And in a certain way, literary success didn't matter. You know, it was just the writing process. It was very pure in that way, although in a way also fear-based, because there's a kind of unwillingness to show it. So anyway, that period of that slowly just broke down. It's kind of like an airplane flying along and the lights start to flicker and the plane shudders, and it's like that, but very slow and over years. And so when I finally got to the point where I could see unequivocally that it wasn't working, I was living in Manhattan and I started to write an article about surfing for a kind of small journal about watching surf films as a kid. And I thought, you live right on the coast. You know, you could go down to Rockaway and actually look at a surf shop and remember what that was like. And when I went down to the surf shop in the middle of the summer, I looked and there were waves and I thought, you could actually go surfing. There's no one out. I'm sure you remember how. And I think I bought a board. I didn't even rent it. I don't think
the guy would rent me a board. I appreciate that story deeply as an addict. I appreciate that story completely. All in, man. Yep. You're like, I didn't rent the board. I was just going to show all in. Who rents boards? I'm all in. This is what I'm doing now.
Uh-huh. That's right. All in, totally. All or nothing. That's so true. And I used to think of all or nothing as a virtue, and now I see it much more ambivalently.
Me too. I think it's like my greatest asset and my greatest liability, right?
I think it's held up as a virtue in our culture, you know.
To say the least.
Total commitment, right?
Yeah.
So I went surfing, and it all kind of came back to life. And that helped me remember earlier joys and earlier body, you know, pleasure. And I was able to quit smoking and quit drinking and quit cocaine. And yeah.
Can we just pause there for one second? Like, you made that sound really easy.
Well, what happened was I gradually realized that I couldn't enjoy the surfing if I kept smoking and drinking and doing the drugs. You know, like, you have to be ready to go surfing in the morning.
Right.
You know, it's like the 4:30 a.m. thing. And it became a kind of choice, like, what do you want to do? What do you want to be ready for? And there's that sense of being prepared physically, you know, and being in shape.
Sure. I loved what you're saying. The pleasure of surfing was greater than the pleasure of using. I mean, that's a really beautiful, it's a beautiful way to say it.
It's also easier, I think, as the pleasures of the drugs and alcohol recede, it gets easier to quit because the return is, there's that kind of diminishment of return.
Yeah.
You know, if you had talked to me the first year I had started, I would have thought, no way, I'd rather do drugs and alcohol and stay in my room with my work than go surfing. But so down the track a bit, it was easier to be persuaded of the trade-off, right?
So then you went back to your greatest love. I love
that.
Yeah,
that's right. Until my first love in a certain sense.
But as we were talking in the beginning, I was listening to you talk about addiction in this kind of negative context, right? Like, and I wonder about this idea just coming to me. Like, I mean, it's like you traded out one addiction for the other. And I think most people would think of that as a negative context, but I feel like as I'm listening to you talk, you're just playing the hand you're dealt, right? You're like, well, if this is kind of who I am, let me at least create this life around something that brings joy. And we come with this void, many of us who turn to eating disorders, alcohol, whatever, gambling, sexting, internet, swipes, likes, you name it. And there's a beautiful part to being an obsessional person, I think. I don't think you could do that writing without it, period.
Right. No, but I do think that there's a kind of lesser and greater addictions or forms of captivities, and that, you know,
I wonder if that's like such an important thing for everyone who's listening, right? It's like maybe we're trying to get rid of the wrong thing, right? Like, I think that's because as we were talking in the beginning, I'm listening and I'm like, well, I don't think if this is who he is, and I think of myself, obviously, this is who I am, maybe I have to kind of radically accept that part of me and then go find how I can be more useful with this particular flavor of personality.
But I also think it's self-protective, because unless I surfed, I would be open to relapse.
Mm.
I'm not surfing strictly speaking as in a positive sense, but it's also defensive. You know, it's kind of like I know myself well enough to know that I need this pleasure and this sense of joy and anticipation. I would really be reluctant to, say, move away from the beach right now. I don't want to, maybe to go somewhere where I could snowboard a lot.
Right. Something there you got the same yeah. High.
I have to have some kind of wilderness thing. And I'm not going to, like, there was that big exodus from the city for me personally. And there was the option of going upstate. And I was like, no, I'm not going upstate.
That's amazing.
It's too far from the water.
But that's, I think this is like amazing. Like, you know who you are and you know what you need. And this is like your big coping tool. I think when people go into recovery from eating disorders and addictions, this is the thing, right? It's like, if you want to know why you're drinking too much, stop drinking too much. But then you got to deal with that thing that, you know, and what you're saying is, well, writing, I think, is quite obsessional, and certainly in my opinion. And then I think the surfing is equally obsessional. And then you're able to be in life in a way that, it sounds like, doesn't bring you shame. It brings you joy.
Yeah, exactly. You know, for me, you know, and I think this is also true. And in this way, I really feel a total kinship with all addicts in recovery. Is just straight up, just sobriety is truly a kind of freedom and a kind of achievement. I definitely felt that more sharply when I first quit everything than I do now, because it's normalized. But I do think that I love just being on time or being where I say I'm going to be and having a simple, relatively simple life without all the kind of trickiness and self-deception and deception of others. I love that.
But isn't that such an important part of life? Like, as we live in this big, shiny, Instagrammed world, to be able to really deeply find gratitude in small things. I mean, I think that's its own coping skill, right? So being able to refocus attention there, I think, is so important.
But I do think that the lesson of surfing is applicable to other things, like other addicts. I do think that everyone who's coming off an addiction needs something comparably intense and pleasurable to get into. And I do think that wilderness is a really big part of it. So, like, I don't think I would be ultimately satisfied just doing, say, I don't know, Brazilian jiu-jitsu, which I'm starting right now, right?
Oh my God. Can you call me and tell me how it goes? I'm so fascinated to hear how you do that.
I got my son
given the book I just read about you, I'd really like to know your relationship with Brazilian jiu-jitsu.
I got my son into it like 5 years ago. So I sat there watching him do it for 5 years, and all the coaches are like, when are you going to start? Looking at me like, when are you going to start? And so now I'm finally starting.
But this is such a gift of sobriety too, though. Do you know what I mean? You're like, sure, why not? I surf, why not? I think this is knowing ourselves, being able to get to know ourselves in this different context.
That's a very intense form. You can become obsessed with Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu really easily. People do that. They dive in. It's infinite. It's still changing all the time. It's not this fixed. It's a relatively new martial art, and it's evolving really fast all the time. So it's got a kind of intellectual appeal to me at that level. But I don't think without the wilderness component, it would hold me.
When you say wilderness component, you mean like the earth, yeah?
The ocean.
Right.
A mountain.
Yep.
The woods.
Yep.
You know, I think that that aspect is really important for feeling small in a good way, feeling reintegrated into the world in a way that's really important for recovery. And for me, I wouldn't risk sort of like saying, oh gosh, you know, I'm gonna set a new goal. I'm gonna be a black belt in jujitsu in, you know, 5 years. I'll write a book about it, and I'm just gonna give up surfing, and I'm just gonna do this one thing because, you know, I know I need to do this one thing. I would be afraid to do that because of the absence of the wilderness component and just the gymnasium and the egos and the sweat and all of that. Even though physiologically, I might feel great. And egotistically, I might feel great because I'd be advancing up the belt hierarchies, right? I don't think it would do for me what surfing does. This is just all speculative.
Well, it's kind of speculative, and it kind of brings me to what I want to talk to you about, because the other thing I really loved about your book is how much science is in it. I feel so grateful that the world is tricky and challenging, but wow, the kind of science that's coming out about how to heal addiction and trauma is so gorgeous. And your book talks so beautifully about why surfing is so useful. But the first thing I want to ask about is one of my favorite topics, which this is like, because I'm so cool, intermittent reinforcement. Intermittent reinforcement is one of my favorite. Don't you just want to hang with me all day? me and my intermittent reinforcement obsession. But can you talk to us about that? Because I loved that part of the book where you're talking about intermittent reinforcement and surfing, and addiction comes with intermittent reinforcement too.
Right. Yeah. Well, that's this concept that comes out of behaviorism and B.F. Skinner. And he was running an experiment with rats, and he ran out of food, and he had to give them fewer pellets to do this one thing. And what he found is that the rats actually focused more on it when it was more random. Like, maybe there's not going to be a pellet there. Maybe there is. The takeaway from that experiment that was basically borne out by lots of other experiments is that, you know, animals, including humans, are going to be more motivated to do something if the reinforcement is random and not consistent. So because you're looking intensely, and this is connected to bioevolution because you have this sense of, well, we really need to figure out what's making that noise in the bushes. And if the noise isn't predictable, you know, it could be dangerous. So there are connections to bioevolution too.
There's also connections to abusive relationships for those of you listening yes. and wondering why you keep on going back to that person when they never call you, and then they call you sometimes and they're inconsistent. It's really interesting, intermittent reinforcement's connection to attachment theory, which yes. is another thing yeah. I love to talk
about.
Well,
that's the whole thing. That's it, right? That's the heart of it right there.
Right.
It attaches you more strongly because it's less predictable.
Right. And if you come from trauma, the other thing I love to talk about, you can get addicted to these people that are inconsistent. You can get addicted to the drugs that are consistent but inconsistent, and all of it. So talk to us about it with drugs and surfing, as you do so beautifully in the book.
Well, with drugs, you know, there's the street drug, just unpredictability of it all, right? And with alcohol, less so, because it's legal and you can go to the bar, and consequently, it's less exciting for a lot of people, because what the brain does is it says, oh, the smell of this bar, the scene in here, and the whole vibe, I know what this is, and I'm going to start creating a countervailing force to keep you sober, to keep your mind focused so you don't step off a cliff or something. The brain is shown to be creating a kind of anti-pleasure to the pleasure we're about to get, we start to anticipate. So the unpredictable is more pleasurable, right? Also, because the brain can't keep up with it as much. With surfing, waves come in, like I was saying, with a hurricane, with a tropical storm, Anna, they come very unpredictably. They're very ephemeral. So I am looking at my computer waiting to see what the next swell is, in a way that I wouldn't be if I were going to play squash and it was just a schedule.
Right. Just side note, you also talk about now appeal in the book, which I love too. I don't know if we can get them together, but maybe we can.
Yeah, now appeal is connected to the prefrontal cortex. And this is a very basic feature of the biochemistry of addiction, which is if you do drugs in a chronic, prolonged way, the communication between the kind of impulsive part of the brain and the prefrontal cortex, which is the executive part of the brain, breaks down. That's what they saw in the late 80s with the PET scans. They go, oh, this chronic cocaine user, his brain has been affected. So the signals telling the impulsive part of his brain not to be impulsive has broken down.
Yeah. You see it in binge eating studies also, and you see it in sugar. You see it literally in everything.
You really see it in binge eating and impulsivity at the level of like, am I going to eat a chip?
Yeah, and hedonistic eating, you see it all the time, which I think is like an underrated, people forget this part. I think what you're saying just with the food stuff is so fascinating because in a way, food is lower down than alcohol, right? Because no one's like, oh God, it's not good. I always say it's like suicide on the installment plan. You know, it's like so low down in its harm, which is actually true in a long-term way that the now appeal, I think, is actually, it's like, oh God, what do you mean? What's the big deal? What's the big deal, right? No big deal.
Yeah. It makes the going surfing that morning or the taking this wave or the eating that chip or doing that line less resisted by the brain. The brain has been broken down by chronic misuse. So the brain is weak and weakened. That's almost like a weak-willed thing. There's that kind of echo of the oral moralistic aspect of addiction, which is you're weak-willed. What the PET scans showed was that people's brains are altered by the misuse, you know, the overuse, and that they can't be held accountable in the same way any longer because they have a brain disorder, right?
Right. And the brain disorder is that they're sort of saying like, oh, these negative consequences are no big deal.
Yeah. Well, there's no thought at all.
Right. Yes.
And that's the now appeal. The mind goes silent. The brain
right.
goes silent.
Not even a conversation.
There's not even a dialogue, right? It completely stops. With surfing, the hold of it is just like, yeah, the unpredictability of waves is very much analogous to the unpredictability of getting the drugs or doing, you know, any kind of availability of the reward. What is the reward? Is it eating the chip? Is it getting good waves? You know, is it getting street drugs? All of those have a different levels of predictability and reward. And if it's unpredictable, it's more intensely in its holding of you.
I really do. I love what you're saying about nature, about wilderness and surfing, but I would imagine that jujitsu will give you that same thing, the unpredictability of like being in the mat. I mean, it's just so interesting about when we're looking to fill a void, it makes sense to look at what appealed to you about addiction so that you can find the joy in other things. Like I love that.
Yeah, yeah. I think that basically the novelty, the risk, and the intensity of something like jujitsu would hold me. The thing that wilderness does that nothing else does is it makes us feel connected to where we come from in a primordial way and makes us feel small in a primordial way that's good. One of the things addiction does that's bad is makes us feel big in a bad, you know, big furnace to fill, you know, to shovel things into. And the wilderness component has that way of creating a reintegrative smallness.
Yeah. And I think this is like really underrated, like the idea of being connected to like Mother Earth. I remember I was 26 years old and my boyfriend took me to Moab, Utah, to Arches. And it was that first moment when I was like, oh, it's bigger than me. I'm okay. You know, like it was like that first, I mean, and then the story was long and arduous like yours, but it was that moment where I was like, oh, and I think that's true of that, the downregulating of nature is so, it's underrated.
Yeah. I mean, in a way, it's not reliable, though, in the sense that I grew up surfing and I moved away from it. Something about my karma, my destiny did not keep me in the safe enclaves of surfing. And surfing doesn't keep surfers from becoming addicted,
oh,
right?
Oh, your book sure talks about that. What was it like interviewing all those surfers? You really got in there, huh?
Yeah. Well, I really identified with them. And I also found it really fascinating, the presence of all that, the kind of grit and darkness of surfing, of drugs and drug addiction in surfing, which is so on the surface, radiantly wholesome and yoga adjacent and all that, right?
Right.
How does that happen? I found that the contrast between the light and the dark really interesting as a narrative, as a concept, right?
Did you find any common themes among the surfers who turn to drugs on top of surfing?
A lot of it has to do with like all the kind of adverse childhood experiences of other addicts. A lot of it's just trauma or some kind of dislocation.
What do you mean by dislocation?
Dislocation in the sense of feeling outside of being unsafe, feeling that kind of insecurity. So in other words, a lot of them had alcoholic fathers who were violent or crazy domestic childhoods. So
that feeling,
it's
that
nothing
different.
Surprising. Yeah. It's nothing unique in the surfers. Right. But the way they handled it and the way it played out within surfing is unique.
I loved in the book how you talked about, I would call it like with this one-mindedness of surfing and how that is healing trauma, and that how there are other methods, there are other things we can do that are so one-minded that it quiets down our trauma. Can you walk me through that in a way more eloquent way than I just did?
Okay, so my experience of going to Camp Pendleton and to surfing with Wounded Warrior Brigade, that's where this idea came in and trauma. When you are in combat and you have something really horrendous happen to your body, to your psyche, the brain is so traumatized by that, it's playing that loop thing, right? And that's why there's so much suicide and so much addiction in among people who are PTSD. In surfing, if you're going under a wave and the wave is blasting you and you're being tumbled like a rag doll, you cannot keep playing the tape. Your brain is interrupted, right? You come up from that little bit of clearance and it's almost like shock therapy. As an analogy, it's actually kind of the way they do shock therapy now is in these kind of light doses, right? But what they're doing is shaking you, right? The shaking the brain.
Right.
Surfing shakes you too. And it shakes these wounded veterans and they come up and they're suddenly like, oh, for a second there, I wasn't thinking about, you know, getting blown up when I was driving the tank. Then there's a little bit of room for a new experience. What is the new experience? It's surfing. It's joy. It's being involved. And it's also a requirement to pay attention to what's coming next because you'll drown if you don't, right? Here comes a big wave. Here comes just the need to be super vigilant because you're a mammal out in the water. There's this kind of basic requirement of wilderness, but specifically in surfing here, of being in the present moment. Being in the present moment is what is the best countervailing thing to do with PTSD. PTSD is being in the past. It's being subject to that loop of trauma. So what you're trying to do is break the loop.
Yeah, you're breaking the loop. I just want to say, like, for whatever it's worth to anybody who's listening, I think that there's a piece of this that I have to say as someone who's recovering and someone who sits in therapy chairs with people, that there's also this underlying concept of joy that you have said so many times. I think someone said to me, like, that the opposite of play is depression. And like the opposite of joy, is depression probably also, but the idea, I think when we're talking about like this fast moving, you know, highfalutin times that we're in, I think joy gets very overlooked. Hedonism doesn't get overlooked.
Right.
Joy gets overlooked in a big way. And how would you define joy?
I think for me, it's just that sense of just being a child of God, you know, just like a completely ecstatic, uncritical celebration, just childlike, you know. I connect it very much to childhood and to a kind of body sense of the world as a place of something that eclipses your criticality. It blows your mind out. You're just celebrating a sort of existence. There's no question about it. Do you know what I'm saying?
I know exactly what you're saying. I just think we might be looking for the wrong thing sometimes. Like when we think about, like, the podcast is called What You're Craving. And I think sometimes, like, I think what you're saying is there are these big feelings that come with surfing, like that totally take you out, but it's like, it's healthy and you're present and you're joyful and you're able to experience these things that you were also looking for in substance. Gave you in substance, but came with such consequences.
Yes, absolutely. No, and I sometimes at this remove, I'm like, well, what? How could that have been? You know, this is maybe one of the trickier, subtler aspects of recovery and of sobriety is you think, well, was it that bad? And was I that weak? And couldn't I afford to just kind of like be moderate now? Can I be a moderate drinker, a moderate whatever? That's the problem with memory in a way, right? And of we can't rely on our memories. We can't rely on our sense of what's safe and what's possible. And
unfortunately, sometimes we have to go back and remember, like, oh yeah, I can't, or I can do that, but the consequences are unfortunate.
Yeah, absolutely.
Those interviews were so forthcoming. What do you think made these people want to talk to you about their stories with addiction?
Well, there is this sort of tribalism in surfing. There's a kind of sense of you're part of this fraternity, sorority of surfers. And there's a sort of like baseline understanding and trust. There's an interesting deviation from that. Or one of the most famous surfers in the world died of a drug overdose. I mean, it's somewhat technically controversial. He was a big drug addict though, right? He had a big opioid addiction. He had a big cocaine addiction. And when he died, he had all these drugs in his, he had a pharmacopoeia of drugs in his system. And a surf journalist tried to write about that, like as if it were Michael Jordan. And everyone in the surf world's like, whoa, are you kidding? You don't talk about this. We don't talk about this to the outside world. You can't, you know, touch this. We know what this is, but we don't talk about it in Sports Illustrated or Outside Magazine or whatever. So that was an interesting moment where surfing had reached a kind of global fame that it had never attained before, just due to media and corporations and whatnot. So this one surfer was world famous. And when he died in under sketchy circumstances, the world wanted to know, right? It wasn't just surfing anymore.
When was this? Like what year?
2010.
Oh, okay. So a while ago in the addictions world.
A decade ago.
Right, okay.
And since then, no one of that magnitude has died of a drug overdose in surfing. And so the premise hasn't been tested, but there was a lot of growth in surfing where surfers had to come forward around the death of that particular surfer and say, you know what, I'm going to get over this tribalism thing. I'm going to talk to the outside world. And so a big documentary was made. Everyone came clean pretty much in the documentary. And there was a lot of airing of dirty laundry about him and surfing in general. And it was very impressive to see surfing kind of transcend this really what was a parochialism.
What do we mean by parochialism?
Like, you know, like we all, you know, everyone surfs. And if you don't surf, you don't know what we're talking about. And, you know, you don't, there's no, it's just small. It's a small world. It's not a major sport.
Well, like keep it quiet, like keep it under the rug so that we continue to look good.
Yeah, we know, but it's not really, surfing had never been subject to the glare of publicity in that, to that magnet, to that degree.
Right.
So it grew, it had to kind of grew. And I think I was benefiting from the aftermath of that surfer's death by virtue of that growth. So when I came around asking about these stories and phenomena, surfers like, oh, okay, yeah, we'll talk about it now. We know that this isn't the end of the world. And in fact, it's good to talk about it because if you talk about it, it's more likely not to happen.
Well, it's like, right. I mean, that's, I just think that piece of this whole thing is like when we tell our stories, it just helps to heal everybody.
So that's, I think, what surfing had appreciated by the time I got around to writing my book. I was benefiting from that.
I love that.
So that's why they were more forthcoming.
So here's a simple question for you. What do you think we're really craving?
I think we're really craving freedom from desire, ultimately. You know, just like freedom. Pure freedom from craving in general, any craving, even surfing, even whatever, a sacrosanct thing that we set up as a forum or a kind of mode. I think that what we're truly craving is freedom from craving.
Like bondage. Like
freedom bondage. From bondage, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think that's possible within those forms of captivity intermittently, like flickeringly. I think that it's not as if I've given up or renounced that possibility. It's just that for me, what works personally on a day-to-day basis is a sense of framework that is, I think, a form of captivity.
Yeah. Yeah. There's some sort of freedom in your discipline. That's how I feel about my life. Like I have this discipline that I have, but it's actually the only way I ever find freedom.
Yeah, exactly. And it's kind of like the way you hear musicians talk about a really strict form, like counterpoint or something. There, you know, there's freedom within the strictures. And that's actually the way poetry would be talked about in terms of rhyme. It'd be like when the move toward free verse came, there was all this sense of like loss, like that's too free.
Right.
And then it evolved and there was an awareness that even within free verse, there's constraints. But within the constraints, there are these moments of freedom. But there's always that sense of a sort of dialectic between captivity and freedom and form and formlessness. And I think that what we're craving is formlessness. But we have to get it through form.
Right. We're craving freedom and we need to get it through discipline, through guidelines, through support, through structure, through holding, as we'd say in therapy.
And I think the really humbling thing about addiction is that you see that you can go off the rails, and that experience or witnessing yourself go off the rails, it's very alarming and sobering, no pun intended. You know, you feel like you can't afford to dabble or to play around when you've seen that happen to yourself. And I think addicts in recovery speak with greater conviction about that kind of thing than other people. You and I are not just talking in a kind of...
We're not like just postulating that this might be true.
We're kind of talking about things that we really cling to as a way to get through experience, right? And not slip into other things that we've seen ourselves do.
Yeah. It's interesting because that's like sometimes what we're craving, which is this, you know, I love what you're saying, which is just like total defiance, just do what I want all of the time, is actually not the answer. The answer is always the balance, right? And so even in surfing, there are guidelines. You can't just go in without, you know, there's always some kind of discipline and guideline you have to be following in order to really appreciate the goods, right?
Right.
I love that. This book is so good. I want to just tell everybody, go buy it. It's really deep and we didn't even get to half the things I wanted to talk about. I love when you're talking about psychotropics in there. I love, there's so much to talk about.